Good morning, everybody. Welcome to our devotional service. We just want to extend our thanks and gratitude to the choir for the rendition of Heavenly Sunlight, followed by Constantly Abiding. We thank God that we are here and Jesus is going to abide with us today.
Amen.
We also want to use this opportunity to welcome everyone else that is watching us over the internet. This is the Apostolic Faith Mission here in the UK at Peckham Road. Number 95, just in case you would like to visit us, please look at the contact details, the address and telephone number, as well as the email address is there. Just establish contact and then we will try and let you come through. But if you live quite close and you would like to come and worship with us this morning, please make your way. We are only just starting the devotional service. Meanwhile, we want to sing praises to the Lord. We use Sacred Songs and Solos number 22. Sister Alois is going to be our song leader for this morning.
SSNS 22. We'll take all the verse 1, 2, and 4. Verses 1, 2, and 4 seated after the introduction by the organist.
No.
Still from the same hymn book, 104, SSNS 104. I have found a friend in Jesus. He is everything to me. He is the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. Amen. We'll take verse 1 and 3 only of this song. Verse 1 and 3 only of this song. Is 787, 787, still from the same hymn book. I am thinking today of that beautiful land.
Amen.
It says, will there be stars, any stars in my crown? We pray that the Lord will help us to have stars in our crown. We'll take verse 1 and 3 only, and we'll take those two verses standing for those of us that can stand. We'll sing it standing, and after which we shall be led in congregational prayers. After the introduction by the organist.
Thank you.
our Father.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we thank you.
Amen.
Jesus, we thank you.
Yes.
Holy Spirit, we thank you.
Amen.
We are gathered here, Heavenly Father, to worship you.
Yes.
To give you glory.
Yes.
We have come as we are, Heavenly Father. Come down, Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Touch each and every life, Heavenly Father. You know where we are at. We thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
Be here, Jesus.
Amen.
And be our God.
Amen.
We thank you.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
We thank you for the souls that are here, Heavenly Father, that need salvation. The souls that need revival.
Yes.
The souls that need sanctification.
Yes.
The souls that need, Father God, to be filled with the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Touch us, Jesus.
Yes.
We need healing that comes from you, Jesus.
Yes.
By your stripes we are healed.
Yes.
We thank you. The souls, Father God, that are wandering about, Father God, not knowing what they need, be here, God, for them.
Amen.
And touch those souls, Father God.
Amen.
We want to make heaven our home.
Yes.
We want to make heaven our home.
Yes.
We are not here, Father God, to see the man that will stand to preach. We are here to see you, to hear you. Open our spiritual eyes, open our spiritual ears, that we will hear through the Spirit that which you want to speak to us. We thank you, Jesus. And we pray, asking all this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. The Bible reading is taken from Philippians chapter 3. We read verses 8 to 10. Philippians chapter 3, verses 8 to 10. Verse 8. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for which I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ, and be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. Verse 10, the last. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death.
I'm happy, I sing because I'm free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart feel lonely and long for heaven and home, when Jesus is my portion, a constant friend is he? His eye is on the sparrow, I know he watches me. His eyes on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm sparrow, and I know he watches me. I've been singing about my Lord for so many years. I have sung when I've been happy, even sung when I've tears. I've asked folks ask me if it's all been just a show, but the reason that I'm singing, I wonder what to know. I sing because there is an empty grave. I sing because there is a power to save. I sing because His grace is real to me. I sing because I know I'm not alone. I sing because I am going home, where I shall sing through all eternity. Saddened faces turning to Arabic smiles. I bowed my head and whispered, Lord, please do the same for me. And I am glad that I can tell you, He's always given victory. I sing because I am not alone. I sing because there is a power to save. I sing because His grace is real to me. I sing because I know I'm not alone. I sing because someday I'm going home, where I shall sing through all eternity. Oh, I sing because an empty grave. I sing because there is a power to save. I sing because His grace is real to me. I sing because I know I'm not alone. I sing because someday I'm going home, where I shall sing through all eternity.
Shall we open our Bible to the reading portion, Philippians chapter 3, I'm reading verse 10. That I may know Him, and the power of His resurrection, and the fellowship of His sufferings, being made conformable unto His death. That I may know Him. It's very important. You know, sometimes if you speak on the phone and the person became very helpful, and you know, sometimes you wish that you see Him and you know Him. The same thing happens in all walks of life. There are certain people that you hear, and you just feel, I wish I see Him. I wish I know Him. And once you meet with the person, you take satisfaction that you have known Him. Somebody gathered his family and told him, I think I heard it in the news, the man had a bowel cancer and he was going to pass away. He just gathered his family and told them that there's no need to be sad, that he has met so many people that he couldn't think that he would be able to reach. He said, I've given handshakes to so many in the world, so it's about time for him to go. There's no need to sad and be sorrowful. So the same thing, there's certain people that you just meet, you feel warm, you feel the affection, but you know it's not the ones we meet each other to embrace, to talk about things, to show love, to cuddle, is not sufficient. It's no way to compare with wanting and having the right desire to know Jesus. Paul the Apostle, if you read from verse 8, he said that he counted everything but loss. So there was nothing more important than him just knowing Jesus Christ and who he is. And that set a remarkable example for ourselves, that the most important thing in our coming to church is that we may know him. Yes. And Paul the Apostle didn't just want to know Jesus Christ, but also the power of his resurrection. Because that is what he felt is going to be the thing that he holds on to till the end. Even if he had seen, like the disciples met Jesus, it was just for a brief period of 3 years and before his crucifixion and then resurrection. But what he left behind for them to hold on to was the power of his resurrection. So nobody has ever met Jesus Christ and genuinely wants to know him that has returned empty-handed. Those who met with him and did not benefit from the meeting are those who did not have the desire to meet him in the first place, who did not have the correct intentions of meeting him. But everyone else, like our Sunday school of last week, the woman who met with Jesus, she must have been desiring. I wish I can just see him. And all of a sudden she had an encounter with Christ. So everything, as far as she was concerned, she was ready to use her hair to wipe his feet. Even the feet of Jesus, you can imagine you now, a visitor walking into your place, how you would feel to wash his feet. It's one of the dirtiest places you wouldn't want to touch in the human body. But here she was. She didn't want Jesus to do it on her own. She just wanted to do it herself. So that shows that there was something really longing. She had the longing to meet him with this Savior. And there were so many other people, the sick, the infirm, the impotent, who was just, if I but know him, that all of my issues will be resolved. And truly, those who met him, they did not go an empty-handed as long as they had the right intentions. So I want to implore you that you have the right intention of coming here today to know Jesus. As far as I'm concerned, when I finish, if I see you and then we shake hands, it means not much, you know. But if you have on your knees known Jesus Christ, and you remain in that knowledge of him, which Paul the Apostle also referred to, and you remain in that very knowledge of him, it means you have heavens to gain. And in the Gospel according to St. John, chapter 14, verse 4, "And whither I go, ye know, and the way, ye know." If you read from verse 3, Jesus is basically addressing his disciples and letting them know that he's going to prepare a place for him. When he comes back, he will come and take him and take them with him to where the place he's going to prepare. And his concluding statement as that particular discourse was that where he's going, his disciples know. And also the way that they know. Yes, I know we are in an era of satellite navigation. Now we can send anybody. I don't know what happened to my brain. I said, let me use the sat nav and see how long it's going to take me to you in Nigeria. And I kid, he said 9 days and some hours. And I was wondering what's going to happen with all the rivers and all. And I was beginning to think, what happened? Okay, even if I take this journey and I want to go by road, because yeah, some of my friends at work in those days that were from North Africa, they used to go by car to, they travel 4 days home and then come back for the big holiday. And I was thinking, what happens to all the visas? What will happen to my passport? What really would be, I couldn't think through. Even though SatNav would take me there, but I was really thinking, how am I going to get there? But you know that Jesus said to his disciples that where he's going, they know. And also the way, they know. He was saying with confidence because over 3 years he has taught them the way to salvation. He has taught them the way to humility, how to pray, how to confess their sins, how to be saved, how to keep their salvation. So in speaking, he did not expect the responses that he got from his disciples. It was like strange to him when the responses started to come, when you will see. That truly means that even though they were following him, there were certain aspects of Jesus Christ they did not truly know. So, and after this, Jesus said that they know where he's going, and they know how to get there. Thomas said unto him in verse 5, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? So, I think, in English they say, I am baffled. I believe that Jesus was baffled. How can Thomas just say that, what a question. We don't know where you're going. And neither do we know the way. So for some of us sitting down here, it might be a situation of not knowing your left from your right. As a teacher, I remember that my wife was telling me a story of one of the classes that she supported when she was supporting a class, and that the students were just not following, not doing what they were expected to do. And the comment from the teacher was that some of us don't know why we are here. And that is the truth. There's some students that just come and then they'll be looking at your lips. You thought that the lesson, you're doing well. Because everyone is quiet and they're listening to you, they're looking at your face. You thought, but then when you now come to test, send through some testing questions, you discover that you were just talking to yourself. I think this would have been the situation that Jesus found himself. These are the people that I have been walking around with for a long time. I've been telling them the things. You know, what is going to happen, how long I'm going to be here for, what they need to do. But now to have a question like this, I felt that he was embarrassed. So may God help us that we do not embarrass Jesus Christ. Amen. That our attitude, our questions, our interaction with him does not embarrass him. You know the way it feels when you have a friend and all of a sudden they put up a kind of behavior that you did not expect. When we were growing up, when somebody does something strange, we just say, oh, I have sinned, it's going to disgrace me. And then you just cover your face. Those things happen, but they are minor. They are minor because here Jesus really was in the belief that his disciples had known all that he taught him, because they were just so few. Okay, and then in verse 6, Jesus said unto him, I am the way, because Thomas said he didn't know the way. And I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also. And from henceforth, ye know him and have seen him. So, You know, Jesus is the best friend to have, according to the songwriter. So he did not want to leave Thomas in any doubt, neither did he want to leave the rest of the disciples, but he condescended to their level. He came down to a level that he can interact with them. Okay, if the teacher hasn't taught, I mean the students has not learned. So it means all that I have been teaching you, you did not quite get it. He told him again the same story, that he's going to his father. And that he is the way. Jesus Christ, that he is the way, he is the life, and he is also the truth. That if anybody has known him, they have known all the rest. They even know the Father as well. And then he admonished Thomas. Okay? Your ignorance has been excused. Now, ye have seen him. It said to Thomas, now ye have seen him. All that you didn't know, I represent that. I represent the Father. I am the way. I am the life. I am the truth. Everything is in me. So there's so many of us sitting down here that have not really, really known Jesus. We come to church, there's nothing wrong with that. We pray in our houses, there's nothing wrong with that. We tell others about Jesus, there's nothing wrong with that. But do you really know him? It's a question for you and for myself. Do you know him to the extent that you cannot fumble? To the extent that you cannot be, nothing can take that knowledge away from you? Or is this just the shallow knowledge? You know, there is something that is called deep knowledge, and there's the shallow one. Do you really have that deep knowledge of Jesus Christ? Because there's no point talking about Thomas and his friends and their mistakes. Let's talk about ourselves. Do we really know him? Come what may, then you will say everything else, like Paul, nothing is important, but just want to know Jesus, that I may know him. He counted everything else but loss, just for the knowledge of Jesus Christ. The people in the world, they know who their fans are. They know what when their fan is coming to town. They will prepare everything. They will buy the ticket. They will fill the car or make sure they have the transport when once their fan is in town. They make sure they go. Maybe an opportunity to see the fan and to see their star in person. But for us, we should really be the super fan of Jesus Christ. If he's our best friend, then we should know him. Quite truly, that what, you know, all other things to one side, because, you know, it's not like when you know him that everything, all that you kept to one side is gone. No, but first to know him and then follow him, and all other things shall be added unto you. That is his advice. Now, after Jesus has finished his discourse with Thomas, Philip also come unto the scene, said unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us. You can imagine his predicament for this about his disciples. And he just finished the same story with Thomas, and someone else is kicking out. This is the same thing with us. That personal knowledge, that personal understanding of Jesus Christ and who he is missing. Once that foundation hasn't been laid in our salvation, then it means anything, any wind that blows is bound to twist it. Now we saw now Philip saying, Lord, show us the Father. He has already said that by when you know him, that you've seen the Father, and that the one in front of you, as it were, as they were meeting, is the Father. When you see him, you see the Father. So for us, do we take him serious? Or is it just a matter of, well, that is what he's saying. But we may bash the disciples now, but you know what? They were frank. They were candid. That there was something missing, that they needed to know more. But for you and I, let's not be pompous. Let's just calm down first. Let's go back to basic. Let's tackle the grassroots of understanding, of knowing who Jesus is. In verse 9, Jesus said unto him, "How long have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip?" Jesus said unto him, "Have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father. And how sayest thou then, show us the Father?" Jesus is repeating, he said, "I've gone through this already with Thomas." And the same thing, I mean, as many of us as are gathering here, you must have read this Bible portion before yourselves, but you've gone through this already. But what about you? Jesus is now addressing Thomas. Okay? He's now addressing Philip. What about you? I've just told Philip, Thomas the same thing, and then you are asking similar question. So may God help us to have this understanding. Amen. That's because Jesus is watching. How are we taking it in? How are we reacting to it? How beneficial is it to our souls? So it was almost like, In current English, it would start like regrettably. I'm surprised. I'm very sorry that I've been with you for so long and you have not known me. And then I've just made the introduction and you've not known me, but he still took it calmly, he still took it gently, he still explained it once more. And that is the reason why I'm here again, to just remind you, do you really know Jesus? And remind myself, have I got what it takes to say that I know him? Am I holding on to him, that whatever wind, no matter how warm or hot the weather is, he will still see me holding on to him through that knowledge that he gives? In verse 10, "Believest thou not that I am the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works." 11, "Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake." 12, "Very, very, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also. And greater works than this shall he do, because I go unto my Father." How many times has Jesus not answered your prayer? You pray, he answers your prayer. That is an example that he is willing to let you know him. He saves you from accident. He delivers you from atrocities. He keeps you happy. He provides for you. So that those are the works of Jesus. Yes. Satan cannot do that. Yes. Not for anybody. And the only thing Satan does is to entice. Tricks, enticement, and at the end of the day, destruction. But that's not the mission of Christ. So in the days that he was having this conversation with his disciples, he could refer them to do works, because they were walking with him. They saw him turn a few loaves of bread into thousands, fed 12,000, fed 4,000 in another account, fed 5,000, you know, healed so many miracles, spoke, and those things came into existence. Those things happened. Just speak, and those things happened. So even if you didn't believe, even if there were some other things in your mind, but at least for what I have performed, use it to know that I am here.
Amen.
And the same thing that God wants you to reflect on all those things he has done for you. God wants you to reflect, to see his supremacy in your life already. A threshold that Jesus has entered into you. The things that he has done are his works, and you use it to them mark how, when you know him truly, how much more he's going to open the gates. And those things that you were languishing for will flourish. Genesis 28. I'm going to read verse 16. Let me start from 15, please. And behold, I am with thee, and will keep thee in all places whither thou goest, and will bring thee again into this land, for I will not leave thee until I have done that which I have spoken to thee of.
Amen.
And Jacob awaked out of his sleep, and he said, surely the Lord is in this place.
Amen.
And I knew it not. Surely the Lord is in this place.
Amen.
But there are so many people that knew it not. There's so many people sitting here or listening to me over the internet that does not really know him. Jacob was, he made a statement here, but if you really read into that statement, you will see aspects of regret. All these years, it's like all these years, where was I? What really happened to me? Why didn't I know this road? You know, because if Jacob had followed the route of his grandfather Abraham, Abraham had already done a sacrifice at Bethel. Jacob must have known about this story. He was from a Christian home, a religious home, a Christian home, where the father must have taught him the word of God. But you know, he decided as a young man to do his own way, trick his brother, took the birthright, go ahead of God. All those were issues in his life that he could look back and, you know, and regret. So God is here. And all of these years that I've wasted, I didn't know him. It doesn't matter how many regrets we have, but regret never corrects the past. It's been done, it's been done, it's over. So now that so God is here and I didn't know. Don't make it be like that for yourself. Don't come to church every day in and out. Don't watch over the internet regularly, and then you don't really know God. Find out who God is. Paul the Apostle said that I may know him. He first of all wanted to search, you know, is an opportunity to want to know. You have to have the hunger and the desire to know first. There and then you will know. So Jacob, in his sleep, God had now appeared to him. At this point of his salvation, he woke up and said, surely, God is in this place. May God make that to be our lot today. Amen. That when we will rise up from prayer this afternoon, we can afford to say, surely, God is in this place. Because this is a place where God answers prayers. Amen. If I were to ask everyone here to stand up and say what God has done for them through this place, through this avenue, through knowing Jesus Christ, we can be here till tomorrow. Because everybody, there has to be a point of saying, this is the act of God. Yes. To even be born, to have life, is the act and mercy of God. So we then should have that hunger to say, if he has done that for me, then if I know him, more will happen. You know how many times probably you have been cautioned in the office, and then maybe something has happened, and you sit down there, yes, on hindsight, I regret my action, or I'm sorry, I should have done it the other way around. Fine, good enough, but already you are regretting. But may God help us that we don't regret our journey at the end.
Amen.
Let's take advantage of what is in front of us and make the best of it. Because that is the whole duty of man, to know God and to keep his commandments. Job was in deep trouble, but he had something that he wanted to know. If we open to the book of Job 13, Book of Job, chapter 13, verse 23. Say, how many are my iniquities and sins? Make me to know my transgressions and my sin. That's a question that's the starting point. You cannot know Christ except you know your transgressions and your sins. You cannot know Jesus Christ very well except you know your sins first and confess them and ask him to forgive you those sins, because that is the door opener. If you don't have a key, you can't open the door unless you want to knock it down by force. But then what we're talking about here, you can't get in by force. It's impossible. There's no other way to get in except, first of all, recognize your sins. Ask him, what is it? Why am I not knowing you? Why are we not having good relationship? What is the matter? Please, just because you remember in the story of Job, it's not new. He was in deep, deep trouble. And even though he was a righteous man, but he could still ask the question, how many are my sins and my transgressions? We can ask God that, because when you have the desire to know God and you ask him these questions, he will open up to you. Yes. Provided you yourself, you are open up to him. So he will come down to assist you and make things known to you. Job said, make me to know. Ask God, please make me to know. Face my transgressions, my sins, so that you can repent of them. There has to be a purpose of wanting to know, and that purpose is to repent. Yeah. It doesn't matter, because if now I call any of you and then tell you about this and that, and that, it's just me speaking. It probably may not have much impact. But if you have a dialogue with God to open up for you, he certainly will do that. Yeah. And you will know. So Job had a confirmation. The psalmist was the same. In Psalm 139, verse 23, he asked, "Search me, O Lord." He asked the question. He left the door open and asked God to search him and even test and try his veins. "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts." So if you feel dislocated from Christ, if you feel that you don't have that inward burns in your heart of the love of God, ask these questions. God is faithful, and he will reveal them to you. Job did ask, and God was also faithful in talking to him. So that is why in Job chapter 13, he asked a question that God should let him know what his problems were, what his iniquities were, and why he was suffering all that he was suffering. Even though we know that he was a righteous man. And in chapter 19, verse 25, He had a confirmation. "For I know that my Redeemer liveth."
Amen.
"And that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth."
Amen.
Why he knew is because he asked in the previous chapter that we read for God to reveal his sins to him, for God to open up and have a dialogue with him. God gives us the same opportunity. Even when you have this desire to know him, the desire to know Jesus Christ is the best thing ever that can ever happen to anybody. To know God, who truly he is, to know Jesus Christ to the depth of the knowledge that is unsearchable and unspeakable. You ask him, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Amen.
That's what the Bible guarantees us. Now Job asked and he had the answer because he had a true mind. The psalmist asked and he had the answer because he had a true mind. You know, because God wants us to know him.
Yes.
It's not like he's doing anything in the secret. There's nothing secret as far as he's concerned. He's happy when we want to know him.
Yeah.
You know, there are some visitors that turn up at your door and you make a statement. Somebody was talking to me yesterday. He said they were talking to somebody who did not attend the church, and people just decided to go and visit. And the person is somebody that was brought up from this culture. He said, "Yes, I saw them. And though they didn't tell me that they were coming, but I welcomed them." That means he would have loved a phone call. God is not like that. God doesn't need any special appointment or any special arrangement. You just tell God, "I want to know you. I have the desire to know you more in depth. What I know now is insufficient. So I want the deeper knowledge of you, God." Sometimes, you know, I don't know how often you really sit down and have a good chat with your children so that they know you. A lot of us are from abroad, and you have children that are grown up in this culture. They don't really know what is happening out where you're coming from. You just want to sit down one day, so from time to time have a good chat. I think most of my children will know my name to the 10th generation because I sing it like song to them. I was carrying one the other day and to drop at the airport. He said, "Where does Akwanotun come from?" I said, "But that is my great-grandfather. His name was Akwanotun." And then you add him more, Isubo, Echangakada. So we go and go and go and go and go. Until what I know And then when I finish from my father's side, I go to my mother's side. And then I can reach also the 10th generation, at the least. So it's like that, because you want your children to know your background. And sometimes your family don't even know you. If you pass on today, they struggle to find the documents, struggle to find your CV. What job was this man doing? Because you didn't let them know you. The same thing with God. He's open up. He wants us to know him. Yes. When we inquire, he will tell us the answers.
Yes.
Let us, may God help us to take advantage of it.
Amen.
Because also, 2 Timothy, start from verse 11. Whereunto I am appointed a preacher, and an apostle, and a teacher of the Gentiles, for the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed,
yes.
And am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day.
Amen.
Nobody ever wants to know Christ and then he's ashamed. There's no need. He will open up the depth and the fountains of knowledge and riches of this world to an immeasurable quantity for each and every one of us. But the first thing first, to know him. And Paul didn't just want to know him. He wanted to know also the power of his resurrection.
Yes.
Right? It was the same thing if you remember the story of Samson and Delilah. Delilah wanted to know, where does all your power come from? So it's not a new thing. And she was anxious, even though she had evil intention against in knowing it. But innocently, something opened up to her. But God is not like man. The knowledge of God is without repentance. And his calling is also without repentance. In our Bible reading again, our main portion, Gospel according to St. John, chapter 14. Verse 18. So, remember Jesus was having this discussion with his disciples. He explained and exposes himself to them. And then, knowing God is never in vain. In verse 13, he told them, and whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do,
amen,
that the Father may be glorified in the Son. And if ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it.
Amen.
Today, as Jesus told his disciples, that when anybody sees him, they've seen the Father, because he's the way, the truth, and the life. And he's also, the Father is in him, and he is in the Father. He threw the challenge. If you have known me, if you really know who I am, ask me something, and I will do it.
Amen.
Then you will have the evidence, the confirmation.
Amen.
that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. So he's throwing the same challenge to us this afternoon, that we may know him, that you pledge something before him today and say, I want to know you. And this is my pledge in response to your word, and see if Jesus Christ will not answer that prayer for you. As we come, the altar is open.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. You have spoken. Now you have given us the privilege to come before the waters and ask whatever we need.
Yes.
You said you will do it.
Yes.
Lord, we want to know you more.
Yes. Amen.
We need you.
Yes. Yes.
Give me that wisdom.
Yes.
Give everyone of us that wisdom of knowing you.
Yeah.
In knowing you, we have everything.
Yeah.
Lord, come and bless these altars.
Yeah.
Touch every soul.
Yeah.
Save,
yeah.
Sanctify,
yeah.
Baptize with the Holy Ghost and fire.
Yeah.
Heal the sick. Yeah. Revive us, Lord.
Yeah.
In the mighty name of Jesus,
yeah.
We pray.
Yeah.